Chapter 3. Steel and the phase-phase diagram. Steel is made by dissolving carbon into iron. Pure iron melts at an extremely high temperature, 2800 OF, 1538 OC, and at such temperatures carbon readily dissolves into the molten iron generating a liquid solution. When the liquid solution solidifies it generates a solid solution in which the C atoms are dissolved into the solid iron. The individual C atoms lie in the holes between the iron atoms of the crystalline grains of austenite, high temperatures, or ferrite, low temperatures. If the amount of C dissolved in the molten iron is kept below 2.1 weight percent we have steel, but if it is above this value we have cast iron. Although liquid iron can dissolve C at levels well above 2.1%, solid iron cannot. This leads to a different solid structure for cast irons, iron with total percent C greater 2.1%, which is discussed in more detail in Chapter 16. In addition to C, all modern steels contain the element manganese, Mn, and low levels of the impurity atoms sulfur, S, and phosphorus, P. Hence we can think of steels as an alloy of three or more elements given as Fe plus C plus X, where Fe and C are the chemical element symbol for iron and carbon, and X can be thought of as third element additions and impurities. In the United States, most steels are classified by a code developed by the American Iron and Steel Institute, AISI. It is customary to partition steel compositions into two categories, plain carbon steels and alloy steels. In plain carbon steels, X consists only of Mn, S and P, whereas in alloy steels one or more additional alloying elements are added. Table 3.1 lists the composition of two common plain carbon steels and one sees that the amount of C, in weight percent, is related to the last two numbers of the code. The Mn level is not related to the code and must be looked up in a table. The first two numbers of the code, 10, identify the steel as a plain carbon steel. These two numbers are changed for alloy steels, and the table lists one example for a chromium, Cr, alloy steel. The alloy steels will be discussed in more detail later. Solid solutions are similar to the liquid salt solution discussed in the last chapter, in that, after the substance has become dissolved its presence is no longer evident to an observer as it had been previous to the dissolving. This may be illustrated for steel as shown in Fig. 3.1. On the left one has a starting condition of a round iron containing only 3 grains. The iron is surrounded by a thin layer of graphite and heated to 1832 OF, 1000 OC. After a period of several hours the graphite layer disappears. The C atoms of the graphite have migrated into the solid iron by a process called diffusion which is discussed in Chapter 7. All of the C atoms have fit themselves into the holes that exist between the iron atoms of the FCC austenite present at this temperature. This solid solution of C in Fe is steel. Figure 1.3 locates the center of the iron atoms in the FCC lattice. Allow each of the little dots of Fig. 1.3 to expand until they touch each other and you end up with the model of FCC iron shown in Fig. 3.2. The expanded iron atoms touch each other along the face diagonals of the cube. The small open circles locate the center of the void spaces between the iron atoms. If you expand these small circles until they touch the iron atoms you find that their maximum diameter equals 41.4% of the iron atom diameter. This means that X atoms smaller than around 42% of the iron atom diameter should fit into the holes between the iron atoms. Carbon atoms are small, but the diameter of carbon atoms is estimated to be 56% of the diameter of iron atoms in austenite. Hence, when C dissolves in iron it pushes the iron atoms apart a small amount. The more carbon dissolved the further the iron atoms are pushed apart. Hence there is a limit to how much C can dissolve in iron. In pure iron the difference in ferrite and austenite is a difference in their atomic structure. As illustrated in Figs. 1.2 and 1.3, the iron atoms are arranged with a BCC crystal structure in ferrite and a FCC crystal structure in austenite. In both ferrite grains and austenite grains this atomic structure does not change as one moves around in the grain. Hence, similar to ice and water of the last chapter, both ferrite and austenite are individual phases.
Historical note. The Iron Age dates to around 1000 BC, when our ancestors first learned to reduce the plentiful iron oxide ores found on Earth into elemental iron. The iron was made in furnaces that were heated by charcoal fires that were not able to get hot enough to melt the iron. They produced an iron called bloomery iron which is similar to modern wrought iron. Even though charcoal was used in these furnaces, very little carbon became dissolved in the iron. So, to make steel, carbon had to be added to the bloomery iron. Even to this day, steel cannot be economically made directly from the iron ore. The modern two-step process first makes high-carbon pig iron and the second step reduces the carbon composition to the steel range. Our ancestors did not know the nature of the element C until around 1780 to 90 AD, and steel and cast iron played a key role in its discovery. Until shortly before that time, the production of steel was primarily the result of blacksmiths heating bloomery iron in charcoal fires. This process is tricky as a charcoal fire can just as easily remove C as add it. See page 63. Therefore, steel was made on a hit and miss basis from the start of the Iron Age, and the quality of such steel varied widely. The successful blacksmiths guarded their methods carefully.
In pure iron, the difference in ferrite and austenite is a difference in their atomic structure. As illustrated in figs 1.2 and 1.3, the iron atoms are arranged with a BCC crystal structure in ferrite and a FCC crystal structure in austenite. In both ferrite grains and austenite grains, this atomic structure does not change as one moves around in the grain. Hence, similar to ice and water of the last chapter, both ferrite and austenite are individual phases. When C is added to austenite to form a solid solution, as illustrated above in Fig. 3.1, the solid solution has the same FCC crystal structure as in pure iron. As discussed with reference to Fig. 3.2, the C from the graphite just fits in between the iron atoms. The crystal structure remains FCC, the only change being that the iron atoms are pushed very slightly farther apart. Pure austenite and austenite with C dissolved in it are both the same phase. Hence, austenite with C dissolved in it and ferrite with C dissolved in it are two different phases, both of which are steel. Low-carbon steels, hypoeutectoid steels, the Fe-C phase diagram provides us with a temperature composition map that tells us where on this map the two phases, austenite and ferrite, will occur. It also shows us where on the map we can expect to get mixtures of these two phases, just like the slush region on the I-salt phase diagram. A portion of the Fe-C phase diagram is shown on Fig. 3.3, and it seems that there is a strong similarity to the salt diagram of Fig. 2.2. In pure iron, austenite transforms to ferrite on cooling to 912 OC, 1674 OF. This transition temperature is traditionally called the A3 temperature, and the diagram shows that, just as adding salt to water lowers the freezing point of water, adding C to iron lowers the A3 temperature. Whereas, the maximum lowering occurs at what is called the eutectic point in water salt, a similar maximum lowering occurs in Fe-C, but here it is called the eutectoid point, and also, the perlite point. The eutectoid point has a composition of 0.77% C, and steels with compositions less than this value are called hypoeutectoid steels, as illustrated in the title of Fig. 3.3. The eutectoid temperature is traditionally called the A1 temperature. Steels that are 100% austenite must have temperature composition coordinates within the central upper dark area of Fig. 3.3. Steels that are ferrite must have temperature composition coordinates in the skinny dark region at the left side of Fig. 3.3. The maximum amount of C that will dissolve into ferritic iron is only 0.02%, which occurs at the eutectoid temperature of 727 OC, 1340 OF. This means that ferrite is essentially pure iron because it is always 99.98% or purer with respect to C. Notice, however, that austenite may dissolve much more carbon than ferrite. At the eutectoid temperature, austenite dissolves 0.77% C, which is roughly 38 times more C than ferrite will hold at this temperature. Austenite holds more C than ferrite because the holes between iron atoms are larger in the FCC structure than the BCC structure. Remember that in the salt water phase diagram, the shaded slush region mapped the temperature composition points where one obtains slush, a mixture of the water and ice. Similarly, the central shaded region labeled alpha plus gamma of Fig. 3.3 maps temperature composition points where steel consists of a mixture of ferrite and austenite. Suppose you were able to utilize a hot stage microscope to look at a polished steel having a composition of 0.4% C after it was heated to 760 OC, 1400 OF. Since this temperature composition point lies in the central shaded region labeled alpha plus gamma, the steel must be a mixture of ferrite and austenite. What you would observe would be a mixture of ferrite grains and austenite grains, as shown at the bottom of Fig. 3.3. The phase diagram also tells you information about the composition of the two phases. The austenite grains must have the composition given as N, and the ferrite the composition given as M on Fig. 3.3. As a further illustration of the usefulness of the phase diagram, consider the following simple experiment. A steel of composition 0.4% C is first heated to 850°C, 1562°F, and held for around 10 minutes. After this short hold, all the grains in this steel would consist of pure FCC austenite grains with a composition of 0.4% C. To make the illustration simple, image that we are looking at the steel in a hot stage microscope and we see a region of only 3 grains as shown on Fig. 3.4. Now the hot stage temperature is reduced to 760°C, 1400°F, and the sample slowly cools to this temperature. What happens to the microstructure? The phase diagram tells us that after cooling, the steel must become two-phase, a mixture of austenite and ferrite. Experiments show that the ferrite that forms in the pure austenite as it cools virtually always forms on the austenite grain boundaries. This is illustrated in the lower microstructure of Fig. 3.4, where the ferrite has formed as a number of alpha grains along the prior austenite grain boundaries. Comparing the microstructure at the right side of Fig. 3.4 to that at the bottom of Fig. 3.3, one sees similarities and differences. They are similar in that both contain a mixture of ferrite and austenite grains with the same volume fraction of each. But they are different in that the distribution of the ferrite grains is quite different. The microstructure of Fig. 3.3 will generally be formed upon heating the steel from room temperature up to 760°C, 1400°F. Hence, this example illustrates one of the fascinating aspects of steels: the microstructure is controlled by heat treatment. As we will show later, the mechanical properties of steels are controlled by microstructure. The microstructure of a steel generally refers to the specific shape, size, distribution, and phase types of the grains in the steel. Remember, the phases present in Figs 3.3 and 3.4 are only present at the high temperature of 760°C, 1400°F, not at room temperature. We will discuss room temperature phases later. High carbon steels, hypereutectoid steels, as the percent C dissolved in austenite increases, the iron atoms are pushed further apart. This stretches the chemical bonds that hold the Fe atoms together, generating a form of energy called strain energy. There is a limit to how much strain energy the austenite can stand. The amount of C dissolved in austenite when this limit is reached is called the solubility limit. Question: the solubility limit in austenite at 820°C, 1508°F, is 1 W/T % C. If you make up an alloy containing 1.5 W/T % C and heat it to 820°C, only 1% of this 1.5% C will be dissolved in the austenite. What happens to the remaining 0.5% C? This excess C becomes incorporated into a new phase called cementite. The new phase, cementite, has one major difference from austenite or ferrite. It is a chemical compound that exists at only one composition. Chemical compounds are generally represented by their elemental formulas, such as sodium chloride, for sodium chloride table salt. The one composition for sodium chloride is 50 atomic percent sodium, which corresponds to 39.3 weight percent sodium. The chemical element formula for cementite is Fe3C. For each atom of C in the compound, there are 3 atoms of iron, giving an atomic composition of 25 at percent C. The corresponding weight percent carbon in cementite turns out to be 6.7 W/T % C. Other than this limitation to one composition, cementite has several similarities to austenite and ferrite. It is a crystal having its atoms arranged in regularly repeating geometrical arrays. The crystal structure is a bit more complex than either BCC of ferrite or the FCC of austenite, but it is well known. Also, it is a separate phase and is present as discrete grains. So the excess 0.5% C in our steel at 820°C, 1508°F, will all be present as separate cementite grains mixed in with the austenite grains, i.e., the microstructure will be a two-phase mixture of austenite and cementite. The Fe-C phase diagram extended to higher carbon compositions where cementite becomes important is shown in Fig. 3.5. As before, the region on the temperature composition map corresponding to austenite is shown as the central dark region. Because cementite exists at only one composition, it is shown on the phase diagram as a vertical line located at its one composition, 6.7% C. Notice that the composition axis at the bottom of the diagram has a break in it just beyond 1.2% and the value of 6.7% is located next to the break. If the break were not inserted, the 6.7% composition would appear roughly 1 foot to the right. To envision the true diagram in your mind, you simply need to extend the right portion over about 1 foot, which expands the shaded two-phase region labeled gamma plus CM into a much large area. The line on the diagram labeled ACM defines the solubility limit for C in austenite. Notice that at 820 OC this line gives a point at 1 W/T% C, which is the maximum amount of C that can be dissolved in austenite at 820 OC, 1508 OF. Alloys having percent C values to the right of the ACM line are in shaded two-phase region labeled gamma plus CM and must consist of a mixture of austenite and cementite grains. Consider a 1095 steel, 0.95 W/T% C, received from a steel mill. If this steel is heated to 760 OC, 1400 OF, it will be at the open circle point located on the diagram with the horizontal arrowed line passing through it. Because the temperature composition point now lies in the shaded two-phase region labeled gamma plus CM, we know that this steel must consist of a mixture of austenite having composition O, 0.85% C, and cementite of composition P, 6.7% C. The diagram does not tell us what the microstructure will look like. Experiments show that the microstructure will be as shown on the bottom of Fig. 3.5. All of the cementite is found to be present as small spherically shaped grains distributed fairly randomly over the austenite grains, which have much larger sizes and are present with the typical curved grain boundaries. To further illustrate the use of the phase diagram in understanding how microstructure changes during heat treatment, consider an experiment where the AS received 1095 steel is heated to 850 OC, 1562 OF, and held for 20 minutes or so. As shown on the phase diagram of Fig. 3.6, this temperature composition point corresponds to the single-phase austenite region. Assuming we could observe the structure in a hot stage microscope, the small region under observation at high magnification might consist of just three grains, which would have an appearance similar to that shown on Fig. 3.6. The temperature of the hot stage is now lowered to 760 OC, 1400 OF, and this temperature composition point lies in the two-phase austenite plus cementite region. This means that cementite grains must form on cooling. Just as is the case for hypoeutectoid steel of Fig. 3.3, where ferrite forms on the cooling austenite grain boundaries, here cementite forms on the austenite grain boundaries during cooling. As shown on Fig. 3.6, one ends up with a microstructure in which all of the prior austenite grain boundaries from the 850 OC structure are filled with thin plate-shaped grains of cementite. Notice the dramatic difference in this microstructure from that shown on Fig. 3.5, where the 1095 steel was heated directly from room temperature to 760 OC. Both microstructures contain the same volume fraction of cementite and austenite, but the distribution of the cementite is quite different. Unlike austenite and ferrite, cementite is very brittle. Consequently, the 1095 structure of Fig. 3.6 with its interconnected CM plates is not as tough as the Fig. 3.5 structure with its small isolated CM grains. Again, this is an example of how heat treatment can change microstructure, which in turn changes mechanical properties. Eutectoid steel, perlite. In the previous two sections we considered steels having compositions on either side of the eutectoid composition of 0.77 W/T% C. It turns out that steels having the composition of 0.77% C, a 1077 steel, generate a unique microstructure that is called perlite. Figure 3.7 presents the phase diagram on which the area below the A1 line of 727 OC, 1340 OF, is shaded dark. This entire area is a two-phase region. Any steel cooled slowly into the temperature composition coordinates of this area must consist of a mixture of the two phases, ferrite and cementite, alpha plus CM. The microstructures of steels in this two-phase region vary widely, and perlite is just one of many microstructures that can occur. To understand the perlite microstructure, consider a 1077 steel that is heated in a hot stage microscope to 800 OC, 1472 OF. As shown on Fig. 3.7, the steel will consist of all austenite grains after just a minute or two at 800 OC after cooling to a temperature below A1, and holding for 5 to 10 minutes or so. The austenite grains will be completely replaced by a new set of perlite grains, as shown on the figure. Contrary to all the grains we have discussed up to this point, the perlite grains are not a single phase. Rather, they consist of a mixture of two phases, alpha plus CM, having a unique microstructure. To observe the true details of the microstructure, one must blow up a small region within a perlite grain to a very high magnification, as shown on the lower right of Fig. 3.7. The structure consists of alternating plates of ferrite and cementite. The ferrite plates are much fatter than the cementite plates, occupying 90% of the volume compared to only 10% for the cementite. At the perlite grain boundaries, one observes an abrupt change in the orientation of the plates, as is shown for a real sample in Fig. 3.8, which is a transmission electron microscope picture at a magnification of 1/1000x. In this picture, the cementite plates are the light phase and the ferrite plates are the dark phase. Note that the CM plates are only 0.1 micrometers thick, too thin to be resolved on an optical microscope. Although CM is brittle, perlite is not, due largely to the fine size of the CM plates. If the 1077 steel is now cooled from the 700°C temperature shown on Fig. 3.7 to room temperature, the microstructure will not change significantly no matter how slow or fast the sample is cooled. The ferrite will remain a nearly pure BCC iron with less than 0.02% C dissolved in it, and the cementite will remain at 6.7% C with an unchanged crystal structure. The phase diagram tells us that once austenite is cooled below the A1 temperature and held for a short period, the austenite will be completely replaced by some form of alpha plus CM, and on cooling to room temperature no further changes in the resulting alpha plus CM microstructure will occur. When we look at plain carbon steels at room temperature, we never see austenite. This means that microstructures containing austenite, such as those shown on Figs 3.2 to 3.5, can only be seen in a hot stage microscope, because the austenite will be replaced by other structures on cooling. At high cooling rates, these include the martensite and bainite structures discussed below. At air cooling rates and slower, the austenite will transform into some form of alpha plus CM.
An exception to this rule is quenched high carbon steels, which contain mixtures of martensite and retained austenite.
The A1, Air1, AC1, R1 nomenclature, the facey phase diagram shown in the above figures, is called an equilibrium phase diagram. This means that the transformation temperatures given by the A lines were determined at extremely slow cooling or heating rates where equilibrium conditions are obtained. The A3, ACM, and A1 lines that appear on equilibrium phase diagrams are often labeled the Air3, ACM and Air1 lines respectively, where the E indicates equilibrium conditions. In this book, the E will generally not be used. The absence of E implies equilibrium conditions. Consider again the experiment illustrated on Fig. 3.7. The diagram predicts that when the austenite grains cool to 727°C, 1340°F, perlite will start to form from the austenite. This only occurs if one cools the austenite extremely slowly. At even modest cooling rates like 5°F per minute, 2.8°C per minute, the transformation temperature is lowered by around 20°C, 36°F. This means that the facey diagram can only be used as a rough guide for estimating transformation temperatures. Not only is the transformation from austenite to perlite on cooling shifted down in temperature, the reverse transformation from perlite to austenite on heating is shifted up in temperature. To give you an idea of the magnitude of this shift on cooling and heating and how it can be measured, a simple experiment was run. A hole was drilled in a small piece of 1018 steel and a thermocouple secured in the hole. The output of the thermocouple was measured with a digital voltmeter every 2 seconds and sent to a PC, where it was converted to a file of temperature versus time. The sample was placed in a small resistance furnace and heated to 870°C, 1598°F, and then removed from the furnace. The output of the thermocouple for both the heating and cooling cycle is shown on Figs 3.9 and 3.10. As explained in Chapter 1, when austenite changes to ferrite on cooling, heat is liberated, and when ferrite changes to austenite on heating, heat is absorbed. Consider first the heating curve of Fig. 3.10. As we will discuss in Chapters 5 and 7, the A3 and the A1 lines of the pure facey diagram are shifted down in temperature by the 0.75% Mn and 0.2% C present in 1018 steel to the values of A1 equals 725°C. And A3 equals 824°C. The heating data of Fig. 3.10 show that at around 737°C the rate of temperature rise abruptly decreases. This is due to the heat absorbed by the sample as the perlite part of the steel transforms to austenite. It means that the A1 line has shifted up by 12°C, from 725 to 737 OC it is customary to label the actual temperature of the transformation on heating AC1, as shown on the figure. The amount of the upward shift depends on the heating rate. If the heating rate were increased above the value of 40 OC per minute, the value of AC1 would increase. On cooling, an opposite effect occurs. The heat liberated when austenite transforms to ferrite or to perlite slows down the rate of decrease in the sample temperature. Figure 3.9 illustrates this effect for both the austenite-ferrite transformation below the A3 temperature and the austenite-perlite transformation below the A1 temperature. The former transformation begins to occur here at 762 OC, which is 62 OC below the A3 temperature of 824 OC, and the latter occurs at 652 OC, which is 73 OC below the A1 temperature of 725 OC, as shown on Fig. 3.9. It is customary to label the actual transformation temperatures that occur on cooling the R3 and R1 temperatures. Notice that the cooling rate for the data of Fig. 3.9 is 3 times larger than the heating rate for the data of Fig. 3.10. This larger rate accounts for the increased shift in the A1 temperature from 73 OC on cooling to only plus 12 OC on heating. The temperature range of Fig. 3.10 did not extend high enough to measure the increased A3 temperature, which is called the AC3 temperature.
Historical note. The same French scientist, Floris Osmond, who is responsible for the name of martensite, is also responsible for the use of the letters R and C for the shift in the A lines on cooling and heating. At the end of the 19th century, he was the first scientist to use thermocouples to measure the effect of heating and cooling rates. The letter R is from the French word for cooling, refroidissement, and the letter C is from the French word for heating, chauffage.